Well, this is Dr. Stan here at the Radio Liberty, coming to you from the hills overlooking beautiful and picturesque Monterey Bay, and bringing you the news behind the news, the story behind the story, hoping to convince you that reality is usually scoffed at, that illusion is usually king. But in the battle for the survival of Christian civilization, it's going to be reality and not illusion or delusion that's going to determine what the future will bring. And I need to remind you the views expressed here are not necessarily those of the owners, management, staff, sponsors, or supporters of the station you're listening to. They happen to be my views, and for the next few minutes, they're going to be the views of Dr. Dennis Cuddy, who, of course, has his degree, his PhD, and certainly in science, and he has certainly taught at the university level. He's certainly been a consultant in the university. He's written extensively on the public health issues and on science, but he's with us today to talk about what's going on scientifically as far as medicine is concerned. Dr. Dennis Cuddy, thank you very much for being with us.
Oh, well, thanks for having me.
Why don't you pick up the story and tell our listeners what's really going on as far as science throughout the world today?
Well, I had usually make a comment about some contemporary events of interest, and then maybe we get into my book, The Power Elite, Their History and Future. The polls recently, they took on the question of gay marriage, showed something like the mid-50s, 54-55% of the public supported it, and only 38-39% opposed it. And that shows how much America has changed, you know, over the last 50 years or so. And as you know, in history, when a nation sort of turns against God's principles, that nation can suffer. So I'm afraid we're in for a rough time coming up in the future. And as usual, I've said, in the past, there's a difference between the American Revolution's values and the French Revolution's values. It sounds the same. We are for liberty and equality and so forth. But for us, liberty is founded on biblical principles, as in the Declaration of Independence, where it talks about we are endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights. And in the French Revolution, when they talk about liberté, they actually mean license. And in America, equality means equal opportunity. And in France, with the French Revolution, égalité, as they would say, actually means a leveling process. And it's a leveling of the masses under these philosopher kings. At that time, they were the encyclopedists. They were the individuals who considered themselves very, very bright, Montesquieu, Condorcet, Rousseau, Diderot, and a lot of these people. And they felt that the people should not be under a monarch. There had been divine right of kings for years and years and years. They said, well, why should those people be the rulers when we're the smarter people? And so the revolution was a revolution in values, not just a revolution in leadership. And so there's a big difference, and it's very much like at the Garden of Eden, where God laid out certain things that one should could do and not do, and actually the only thing you couldn't do was eat of the forbidden fruit. And the people, in that case Adam and Eve, were supposed to follow that, and everything was fine as long as they did. But then when Eve and then Adam decided to be their own ultimate moral arbiter as to what was right or wrong for them, we got in the mess that we're in. They get released or put out of paradise. And basically, that's what the French Revolution was about. The difference between a biblical-based society following the Bible, the American Revolution, and the values, and the French Revolution, like Eve, the French Revolution, the liberté, meaning I'm going to decide for myself what I want to do or not do. And so you have the same situation again today. Apparently, America.
Hold that thought. We'll be right back. Well, this is Dr. Stan. Our guest this afternoon is Dr. Dennis Cuddy. Dr. Cuddy, of course, has taught in the university level. He has certainly written books. He was in the Department of Education, certainly during the Reagan administration. But he's a prolific writer, and we carry many of his books, at least all those who are in print today, going into the background of the secret societies that rule the world. And ladies and gentlemen, there really are secret societies out there, and you're not going to hear about them because the media is tightly controlled by six or seven major corporations that control 90% of the media and control most of the universities, and as a result, why they largely determine what the American people think and read and actually believe. And Dr. Cuddy is simply talking about the degree of control that these people have over our minds today. And basically, the average individual has very little idea about morality or freedom. And they've changed the moral foundation of this country. Whereas we were once a moral nation and a Christian nation, that is no longer true today. And they've changed the music. You remember the songs we used to sing in church? Well, we don't sing them anymore. And suddenly the thrust of our teaching in church used to be entirely different than it is today. Dennis, you go right ahead.
It's the same sort of flow that began with Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, and then more recently, a couple of hundred years or so ago, with the French Revolution versus the American Revolution. And then we have today the same sort of situation where America, 100 or so years ago, had a certain biblical basis to it. You would find people regularly attending church. You would find most people shunning fornication and adultery and so forth. I mean, it always happens throughout history. But basically, it was that sort of mindset, biblically based, traditional values, moral absolutes, and so on. But then, with the changing of values, and there's various ways in which it was done. Antonio Gramsci said they would attack the culture, and he was one of them who promoted this this change. And then you had a number of others, which we don't have to rehash that. But about 70 or so years ago, there was a real assault that began on many, many different fronts. It began in art, it began in music, in educational systems, and health, and so on. And so gradually, over the past 50 or 60 years, what you've done is had the culture or the society as a group. Individuals have always done these sorts of things.
Hold that thought, Dennis. We'll be back in just a moment here with our full others. Well, this is Dr. Stan, and Dr. Cuddy is simply talking about the fact that society is changing, and this has been going on for about 70 years. There's been a coordinated effort to change our values, to change our attitude towards God and family and country and morality. And basically, they've infiltrated our universities, they've infiltrated our churches, and so the attitude is has changed dramatically, and the attitude towards so many people today is no longer certainly against sex outside of marriage or in favor of true morality. In fact, most people don't even really see anything terribly, terribly wrong with homosexuality. If that's what people want to do, we'll go right ahead, Dr. Cuddy.
And individuals throughout history, there have always been individuals who do their own thing at various times and various places. But what happened in America was a group change, and that also was planned. You have various people, as I said, in various ways. Theodore Adorno developed out of the Frankfurt School a sort of fractious music, and that would do certain things to society. And Bertrand Russell with the impact of science upon society, and verses and tones repeatedly intoned, so that a group of people or an entire society, when they got to the point of thinking snow was black, then you would not any longer need armies or police or anything like that. And so there are various people who would explain these over the years, and if you look back, you can see it happening. If you look even today, what you'll have are certain channels on television which will show programs from the 1950s. And so if you look at The Donna Reed Show, for example, from the 50s, or Leave It to Beaver from the 1950s, or Ozzie and Harriet from the 1950s, you see there a certain deference of the children to the parents. If you see The Rifleman, for example, with Chuck Connors and his son, for example, you'll see the son and say, "Oh, Pa, you know, can I do this, Pa?" And the, you know, the boy wants to get a job part time, making 50 cents a day, so that he could, you know, get a pony or something like that. And it's always sort of yes, Pa, no, Pa, and I'll check with you. And in the Donna Reed Show, the daughter, played by Shelley Fabre, or the son, asks the parents, and the parents say, "Okay, now be sure to be home by 11. Yes, yes, Mom, I'll be, you know, that sort of thing. But then, when you look at the 1960s and what happened, you start to have, and this is not by accident, you start to have what was called the students' rights movement, you know. And I could see it in school. When I was at a particular junior high school in 1959, we looked at school as almost like a business. You would come, you would be mannerly to the teacher. The teacher was right. I mean, of course, sometimes some teacher would, you know, do things they shouldn't. But for the most part, you, the student, and the parents assumed the teacher had your best interest. And so you sat there, you know, quiet. You didn't throw paper wads all over the place or challenge the teacher. And by the time the end of the 1960s rolled around, I had gone through college and came back to the same school and was now a teacher in 1968, that I had been a student in 1959. And you could immediately see a sense of change had occurred. The principal had been a real strict disciplinarian. But now, at the end of the 60s, the same principal was there, but he was different. I would ask the other teacher, you know, what happened? You know, what's the difference here? And they said, the other teacher said, well, one time this student was very, very rowdy and just, you know, was totally uncontrollable, and he was, you know, disciplined students, and then expelled the student, suspended him, and then expelled him. It's just incorrigible. But the parents of the student went into court, and the court forced him to take the students back under this sort of, you know, students' rights. You're inhibiting the child's creativity. some such nonsense. And so the principal just said, well, what's the use? I mean, he just threw up his hands like that. And that sort of change through the courts, it was a sort of positivist notion. Earlier in the 20th century, the early 1900s, you had Oliver Wendell Holmes and Felix Frankfurter, and these were the positivists who said, well, the Constitution means whatever I say it means. They didn't feel constrained by the original intent of the founders when the Constitution was adopted. And that began, that positivism, in the late 1800s. And we've been through that. That's Auguste Comte with his system of positive polity. And I've been through that in the middle 1800s. And Auguste Comte was the secretary of Saint-Simon, who was a member of the French Revolution. See, I mean, you can see this thing going on for 200 years, the change. And so here you have the courts basically telling principals what they can and cannot use in terms of discipline. And once you break down discipline, of course, students see this, you know, and if Johnny can get away with it, well, then Jimmy wants to get away with it, too. And so the whole thing turns into one big zoo. Now, I had a lot of wonderful students. I did. But you had some rowdy ones, and you just had to, you know, do the best you can. And so what happened was I saw my old high school teacher from the early 60s, and she was very, very good in English. She was a senior English teacher, very, very good, strict disciplinarian, not cruel or anything, very strict, and you really learned. You really did learn. And in her class, senior high school English, it was basically your first year of college. So when I went to college, it was almost like a repeat. She was very, very good, very good. Well, I came back to visit that school later, and there she was literally chasing some student down the hall because he just wanted to do his own thing. Shortly thereafter, you find out that those teachers, the very, very good teachers from like the 1950s and early 60s, they just quit. She quit. They all quit because they said, you know, I've been here 30, 40 years. Why should I, you know, put up with this nonsense? And these students who believe they have these students' rights, you know, my creativity and don't inhibit me and, you know, I have freedom, you know, the French Revolution license, in other words. And so they said, well, I don't need this. And so they would quit. So what did that leave? It left a lot of young, inexperienced teachers. And so in the 60s, in the beginning around 1960-64, is when you started to see SAT scores go down. You started to see the nationally standardized test scores go down, and they're dumbing down. And the point I'm making is not by accident. And you can trace this stuff right back to the French Revolution, which in effect was doing what Eve and Adam did in the Garden of Eden. And so that's in education, in music, the same sort of thing. Once you devolve away from standards, you create a certain chaos. So, for example, there used to be standards in music, and I've written about this. I'm not going to belabor it, but whenever you have standards in music or art or whatever it is, you have a foundation upon which to judge something as to its value. But if you do away with standards, then basically anything goes. Anything goes in art. You know, throwing a can of paint on a canvas and rolling a bicycle over it becomes art. You know, and who's to say it's good or not? You know, if you say, well, that's rotten art, they would say, according to whom? You know, you? Well, that's your opinion, you know. I have my opinion. You have your opinion. You know, everybody has their opinion. And so there's no longer a standard of what constitutes good art or good music. Music, then, what happens is they devolve. They devolve. They degenerate back to a sort of primitive state, right? And so instead of music having certain qualities, certain tonal qualities, the voice or the instrument, or your ability to hold a note with purity, in if you're singing like that, it simply becomes yelling. You know, the person who can yell the most is supposedly exhibiting their feelings and emotion, and of course that becomes good music. Their voice may be crummy, I mean absolutely horrible, but it doesn't matter because they're showing their emotion and real feeling, right? And remember, I told you what they did was they turned the society and school and all of these things from logic, the cognitive domain, to the affective domain, because under the affective domain, social relationships and feelings and such, they're more easily manipulable. And so you can use art to manipulate, you can use music to manipulate. And you say, well, how do you use art to manipulate? Well, there's a famous statement by Bertolt Brecht, a very famous artist. He said, art is not a mirror that you put up against reality, but it is a hammer with which to remold reality. And remember that term, remold. That's the Fabian socialist. We want to remold it nearer to the heart's desire. And so this is all a plan. It's, you know, psychological plan for music, plan for art, plan for education, plans for sports, you know, whatever it is. You say, well, what do you mean, sports? Well, it's the same thing. Once you change standards, like let's say you go for baseball from 154 games to 162 games, then you say, oh, look, we've got a new hero because he is hitting more triples or home runs or whatever. Well, so what? Yeah, if you lengthen the season by 8 games, of course they're going to do it. But they do that for a particular reason. They want the new hero, you know, the new person to look up to and so forth. And so what you have is almost a changing in a way which becomes, as I said, sort of primitive. And so instead of music having about 5 or 6 things that you would judge, like when I went to the governor's school, which was the first one in the nation, it's funded by Carnegie back in the 60s, and now every state has the thing. We had to be able to do certain things. You had to be able to sight read music, you know, a cappella, and you had to read, you know, you had to read the music, and you were judged by a certain tonal quality and the purity and all this sort of stuff. Well, once you do away with that, then who are you to say that the beat isn't what's most important? Okay, so beginning in the late 50s and then in the 60s, that's what all the people, especially the young people, said, well, look at the beat. It's got a good beat. They forgot about everything else. It was only the beat. Well, what's that? That's primitive. That's the way the early primitive tribes did. You know, beat on the drum, bang, bang, bang. And that was music. You know, the rhythm of the beat, the tempo of the beat, but it was all the beat. Instead of, you know, purity of tone and sound and crescendo and, you know, all
of course,
of
the beat stuff. The beat has an impact on us emotionally,
right.
And this is what people don't understand. There is certainly this other level of intelligence that's influencing our outlook of the world. Dennis, you go right ahead.
Okay, well, I don't want to go on too much about it, but it was a multi-phasic, multi-aspect attack upon the culture. And it was all planned, and I've been through it, so I don't want to rehash it. But the point is, there had always been individuals who would be exhibiting aberrant behavior. But what this did was get the entire culture, the entire society. And so once you have the entire society going along with something, then what you would find is disobedience in the 60s. You would find students, children, just children at home, rebelling against the parents. Demanding to know why I can't do this and why I can't do that, just like in the schools, student rights movement. You would have rebellious parents. You would have young adults supporting that, like Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton wrote an article in the Harvard Law Review, I believe it was back in 1973, and what she was saying, coming out of this sort of genre of change, which was planned, she said, I'm going to summarize this, she said, if you can't show a good reason why somebody can't do something, a child can't do something at 17, then why can't they do it at that age, or 16, or 15, or 14, or 13? In other words, she was backing down the rights, the independence of these children who previously had been considered children, and therefore they should listen to their parents. They're adults, you know, under their supervision, their guidance, and so on. And so you would have previously age and wisdom was respected. Now they changed that. You know, an old person, well, they're just an old fogey. Well, why did you call them an old fogey? Well, because they weren't with it. They weren't modern. They weren't hip, or various other slogans from the 1960s. And so what had been valued before, wisdom, intelligence, and so forth, all of a sudden was changed to not a positive thing, but something actually negative. Why? Because they weren't changing. See, change was important. You have to be willing to change, do new things. And remember the quotes I've given from Orwell's book, 1984, when the protagonist, O'Brien, was torturing Winston in the, you know, chamber of love or whatever it was. And Winston said, well, we'll never go along with this authoritarianism. And O'Brien said, yeah, but what if we quicken the tempo of human life? Well, quickening the tempo of human life means change. So it used to be you'd get a pair of pants or a suit or something. You'd say, boy, I hope this thing's sturdy, you know. I hope this suit or these pants will last 10, 15 years. You know, I'll get my money's worth out of these pants. Well, that was no longer the case in the late 50s and 60s, right? It was the new fashion. No, I got to have a new tie. It's got to be a skinny tie. The next year it has to be a wide tie. The next year it has to be a long tie. The next year it has to be a short tie. So all of this stuff is programmed, and that's what Edward Bernays did, the father of public opinion. He wrote that book, Propaganda, in 1928, who said, we know how to manipulate you. In the late 30s, he gave an example of this by promoting Lucky Strike as a cigarette, and the cigarette has a white package, pack of cigarettes, Lucky Strike, with a red bullseye. And they wanted to come out with menthol, and so they said, well, we're going to have a green bullseye and a white package. That would be the menthol. And so he went to the garment district of New York City and paid them a ton of money to make the fashions for the next year, red and green. And so everybody's doing, you know, wearing red-green dress.
Okay, well, this is Dr. Stan. Our guest is Dr. Dennis Cuddy. Dennis certainly is talking about what's going on behind the scenes and how our reality has been altered. And certainly Dennis has written a number of books on the power elite, this small group that really runs the world. So, Dennis, did you want to get to the major subject for this afternoon?
In a minute, I'll whiz on through, because these things are that I'm talking about relate to the paralyte, their history and future, because the chapter that we're on has to do with misdirection. And so in the book, which would be the main thing that we're talking about now, the Power Elite, their history teacher, in Misdirection, is the previous chapter was on psychological conditioning of people. And so just summing up this particular thing, that's why you can have a whole society go along with the disobedience by minors to their elders in the 60s. And you can have, through evolution being taught and promoted in schools, you can have things like abortion accepted because it's under women's rights in the early 70s. And then you come after that to homosexual rights, and, you know, you progress to gay marriage, which is on the docket today in any number of states and the courts. And so what you see is that a society which 70 or so years ago had traditional values, whether it's the relationship of children to their parents or students to their teachers, or the respect for the sanctity of life, which is included in the Declaration of Independence, now all of a sudden, within a relatively short time, has changed as a group. And so this, the latest poll, which is what I began the program with, that the American people as a whole, about 54-55%, now say, well, gay marriage is okay. And only about 38-39% say it's not. Well, where does that come from? That's the French Revolution, not the American Revolution, the French Revolution. So within a relatively short time, that's what you have. Now I'm going to deal with one other aspect, which has to do with this particular chapter of the Power Elite, their history and future, which is the topic that we've been covering, going through the book offered by Radio Liberty week by week. And that deals in foreign policy, where you have the Ukraine and what happened in the Ukraine in terms of foreign policy and what the U.S. didn't do and what the former Soviet Union, now Russia, did do. And the tactic there, and I'll explain this sort of briefly, is, as I've said before, what you have is a crisis. The Power Elite presents a crisis. There's a reaction to the crisis, and they use the reaction to further their goals. So, for example, you might have the Ukraine, which is a basket case in terms of economy. So they have a revolution. The reaction to the crisis is the Russians moving into the Crimea. Now, just like in Georgia, the nation of Georgia, they occupy certain areas. Why? Maybe they want a warm water port. You can't rely on St. Petersburg or Vladivostok all year round. And so our reaction to the crisis, the American reaction, is now we've guaranteed the Ukraine $1 billion in loans, which otherwise we would not have done. And so if you remember that movie, The Mouse That Roared, this little nation comes up with sort of a blackmail of a nuclear weapon that it's going to use against us, and then it surrenders if we give them a ton of money. So that's one thing that I think is going on in the Ukraine now. You want to get the sucker American taxpayers to put up $1 billion, which otherwise they wouldn't have done, and so you have this crisis. You have the Russians reacting to this crisis by invading the Crimea and so on. And the other examples would be like 9/11. For example, you have a crisis, the attack of 9/11, and the public reacts to the crisis by saying, oh, my goodness, what are we going to do for our security in the future? And then they immediately present the Homeland Security Act and Patriot Act, and which is what they wanted all along. Same thing with the Cuban Missile Crisis. You have the crisis, that's the Cuban Missile Crisis. We react to the crisis saying, get your troops, Khrushchev, out of Cuba, get your missiles out of Cuba, and then they say, okay, if you promise not to invade or try a Bay of Pigs or any invasion of Cuba anymore, which is what they wanted all along, so that they could use Cuba as a revolutionary training base for Nicaragua and the rest of Central America, as well as Angola and the rest of Africa. And so this is the type of thing that you have, and in a way that's a use of misdirection. You think it's one thing, the crisis, but then what they do is use the reaction to the crisis to get what they wanted all along, which is, in effect, a type of misdirection, which is this chapter that we're on. When we get back from the break, we'll pick up with the book.
All right, fine. Well, of course, our guest is Dr. Dennis Cuddy, and we're talking really about what's going on behind the scenes. You must understand, ladies and gentlemen, that most of what you read in the newspaper is controlled. 90% of our major newspapers, magazines, publishing houses, television, radio, are controlled by what I call the Brotherhood of Darkness. And basically, we carry a book. It's written by a liberal college professor, but it's called The New Media Monopoly. You need to get it. The New Media Monopoly. It points out how six major corporations in the year 2004 controlled over 90% of the media outlets, control what we think and believe. You've got to be able to think independently. We'll be back in a moment. Let's go right ahead. Dennis, go ahead.
Okay. Well, then, picking up on the main topic, which is the power elite, their history and future, my book, latest book, which is offered by Radio Liberty, we're at the end of the chapter on the use of misdirection, which fits with all of the comments that I've previously made. And I'll just give several examples from the end of the chapter. For example, we had already had a no-win war strategy in the Korean War, the late 1940s and early 1950s. And so, once again, even though you think we would learn from this mistake, in the 1960s and early 70s, you have the Vietnam War. And that began over the American reaction to the crisis of North Vietnamese PT boats attacking a U.S. destroyer on August 2nd, 1964, supposedly, in the Gulf of Tonkin. Later, of course, it was discovered that the attack had never occurred. So once again, the American public was misdirected so that we could get involved into that war for various reasons. Dr. Stan has explained that, and I've explained the real reason for Vietnam in the past. The next major conflict that I'll get into was the 1991 with the Gulf War. And that's when the U.S. Attacked Iraq, and that misdirection was similar to the misdirection of the First World War. Remember, the First World War, the British misled the Germans into thinking that if the Germans sided with the Austro-Hungarian Empire against Serbian Russia, that Britain and France would enter the war. But basically, Sir Edward Grey just lied. And the same thing happened with the U.S. and Iraq when April Glaspie, the U.S. ambassador to Iraq, led Iraqi leader Saddam Hussein to believe that his invasion of Kuwait would not be met with an American military response. And remember what they had been doing. Kuwait had been slant drilling under Iraq and sucking out the Iraqi oil. And so Saddam said, don't do it. They continued. So, you know, what was he going to do? So he invades, and of course they have all kinds of lies about, you know, the evil Iraqi forces were in there in hospitals throwing babies on the floor. Of course, the person telling that story was the Kuwaiti ambassador's daughter, but when she testified before Congress, they forgot to admit tell the public that little detail. And so it's very similar to previous wars where we said the First World War, we have to go to war because those journeys were called Huns.
Well, this is Dr. Stan. I guess it's Dr. Dennis Cuddy, and he's going into the background of how we get from war to war, and they're all contrived, certainly. I mean, certainly we supposedly went to war with Vietnam because of the Gulf of Tonkin incident, and then all shucks, we found out it just didn't occur. We went to war with Iraq because, of course, they had weapons of mass destruction, and all shucks, after we'd killed all those people, tens of thousands of people, suddenly we found out they didn't have any weapons of mass destruction. Oh, shucks, just another mistake. Ladies and gentlemen, we're not making mistakes. All of these wars are contrived, and the American people go right along with it. Of course, we went to war with Afghanistan because, of course, the Islamic radicals had taken down the Twin Towers and Building Number 7, the World Trade Center. But then, of course, if you you go ahead and you look at what happened, why, of course, the so-called Islamic terrorists that took them down. 15 of the 19 came from Saudi Arabia. So if 15 of the 19 came from Saudi Arabia, why did we attack Afghanistan? Well, it was because Osama bin Laden was there. And then, of course, we argue with that. Osama bin Laden said, I had nothing to do with it. All you need to do, ladies and gentlemen, is go on the internet, go to our website or anything else, and look at Building 7 and watch it come down. It's obviously a controlled demolition. The center of the roof caves in first, then the base of the building goes up. It's a controlled demolition. That city was taken down artificially. It wasn't taken down by terrorists. It was a controlled demolition, and the entire war against the Islamic world that began back there in September of 2001 is all phony, and all the people who died, and we're talking about hundreds of thousands of people have died over there, have died for absolutely nothing. It was all contrived. Go right ahead, Dr. Cuddy.
Okay, well, the first Gulf War of 1991 was the misdirection by April Glaspie, very much like the First World War, where Sir Edward Grey misled Prince Lichnowsky of the Germans, and I've been through that. And then at the end of the 90s, you had American NATO involvement in the Bosnian War, and that really followed the pattern of World War II's misdirection. Because the U.S. reacted to the humanitarian crisis it said was occurring in Kosovo. Well, that crisis occurred, however, because Yugoslav leader Slobodan Milosevic was reacting to the crisis of the KLA, the Kosovo Liberation Army terrorists, inciting the murder and the chaos there. According to James Bissett, who was the former Canadian ambassador to Yugoslavia. Of course, you wouldn't hear that in this country. This is in a Canadian paper, the Toronto Globe and Mail. You can check it out, July 31, 2001. He wrote, and remember, this isn't just some guy with an opinion. This is the former Canadian ambassador to Yugoslavia, July 31, 2001. He, James Bissett, wrote an article in the Globe and Mail, that's the Toronto newspaper. It was titled, "We Have Created a Monster." And in there, he said the CIA and British Special Armed Forces armed and trained the KLA in Albania to foment revolution in Kosovo, which then resulted in the assassination of Serbian mayors and ambush of Serbian police. So, you know, what's Milosevic supposed to do? But you have the humanitarian crisis, and so, aha, NATO now gets to intervene. And then, as Dr. Stan said, in the early 2000s, the Iraq War of 2003, followed a pattern of World War II as well, where the American public was misdirected against Iraq after the U.S. had attacked the Taliban in Afghanistan. And this American military response was a reaction to the crisis of September 11th, 2001, upon the World Trade Center and the Pentagon by al-Qaeda, which was harbored by the Taliban in Afghanistan, as Dr. Stan said. So you have these various types of misdirection used, and one of the more most recent ones, of course, involved Syria and Turkey. And it's not just the case of where did Saddam Hussein's chemical weapons go. They were sneaked over into Syria, which we knew all along, right from the beginning. But in that case, the reports indicated that the U.S., once again, NATO, was considering helping the NATO member Turkey, and Turkey was reacting to the explosive shells from Syria that had been falling upon Turkish land, and that would, as in the case of Kosovo, give the U.S., NATO, an excuse to respond to the humanitarian crisis occurring in Syria. As the forces of Hafez al-Assad, their leader, reacted to the crisis of externally funded armed revolutionaries within Syria trying to overthrow the government there. So at the end of the chapter, I give those several examples of the responses to crises, the reactions to crises, which the power elite then uses to accomplish whatever it wants, whether it's the 9/11 or Syria and Turkey or whatever it is, Libya, same sort of thing. And so that concludes the chapter, the use of misdirection. And the next chapter in the book is titled Oklahoma City Bombing Anniversary. And that I chose as a specific example of how the power elite manipulates things under their ultimate plan, and below that, of course, the Secret Nazi Plan, which is the title of my previous book, The Power Elite and the Secret Nazi Plan, which is also offered by Radio Liberty. Now, in that book, the book about the Power Elite and the Secret Nazi Plan, I had referred to the infamous Nazi named Adolf Eichmann, his associate, his close associate, whose name was Otto von Bolschwig. Whom Alan Dulles, who would become, he was head of the CIA under President Eisenhower. So Alan Dulles had helped this fellow, Otto von Bolschwig, immigrate to the U.S. in 1954, just 9 years after the Second World War. Dulles is doing this stuff. I mean, he's working with SS officer Paul Dickoff right from, practically the beginning of American involvement in the Second World War, and he continues right on through. And, of course, he's aware of the secret Nazi plan. And so he helps Bolschwing come here in 1954. And according to a book by John Loftus and Mark Aaron, titled The Secret War Against the Jews, Bolschwing had said that in any future war, the support of the Muslim world was essential to Hitler's plan. And that's what I've said. You know, the Nazis had allied with the Muslim Brotherhood beginning in the 1930s. And so in the fulfillment of this secret Nazi plan, which they said would perhaps be about two generations after the Second World War, which would be about now, that the role of the Muslim Brotherhood would be an extremely important part of fulfilling that secret plan for world control. And it's coming about as we speak. Now, from the Muslim Brotherhood, of course, there are various offshoots. For example, Hamas, H-A-M-A-S. Hamas comes from the Muslim Brotherhood. And if you look at the book by Stephen Emerson, he also has a good video from 1995, I think, and PBS only showed it once, and, you know, it was in short again. And later on, they came back to him and said, you know, maybe we made a mistake on that, because he showed terrorists within this country going around the country and asking for money so American blood could, you know, flow in the streets and all this. But anyway, Stephen Emerson wrote a book called American Jihad, The Terrorist Living Among Us. And in that, I got the book, and I looked in it, and I saw, I think if you open it right in the middle, he has this map. You can sort of unfold this map. And he listed Hamas as having groups and conventions in Oklahoma City. The Oklahoma City, right? I mean, that's, you know, he doesn't say Seattle or something. It's Oklahoma City specifically. So Hamas has a very, very heavy presence in Oklahoma City, and that'll become relevant here.
And I think we're talking about an Islamist terrorist organization.
Right.
What are they doing here in Oklahoma City? Very simply, ladies and gentlemen, a lot of this whole world Islamic terrorist movement is being organized and funded from the United States. I mean, who organized the Muslim Brotherhood? They were originally organized in 1928 by MI6, British Intelligence, and we took it over following the Second World War, and we've funded the Muslim Brotherhood ever since then. And you can go up on the internet, you can find articles on that. You'll never hear this mentioned by the controlled media, because you're not supposed to understand how this all fits together. But we've created the best enemy money could buy. How can you get the people to give up their freedom? How can you get the people to allow the government to be reading all of our emails and listening to all of our telephone conversations and reading all of our faxes, if only that we were protecting ourselves from those wicked terrorists who we've funded and we continue funding today with the best enemy money could buy? Go right ahead, Dennis.
Right. And just as an aside, I was surprised when I looked at that map that the city that I live in had the terrorist group called Islamic Jihad. It was in the city that I'm in. I said, what? In fact, though, I think my mother ran into them back in the 1970s, because I remember we were going to this copy center. And there were these really sort of arrogant people sort of almost shoving her aside to use the copy machine. They had these boxes, I mean, just boxes full of documents. And she and I remember we would look at each other and say, I wonder what those people are making copies of and where they're sending them. So anyway, relevant to the Oklahoma City bombing that occurred April 19th of 1995, there's a writer named Jim Crogan, C-R-O-G-A-N. And he wrote an article in a publication called L.A., Los Angeles, L.A. Weekly. It was for the week July 24th through 30th of 2002. And he was titling it An Oklahoma Mystery, New Hints, H-I-N-T-S, Hints of Links Between Timothy McVeigh and Middle Eastern Terrorists. Interesting subject. And in there, they wrote that, quote, an undated intelligence report by director of the U.S. House of Representatives Task Force on Terrorism and Unconventional Warfare, whose name was Yosef Bodansky, a report there, undated intelligence report by Bodansky, discusses alleged terrorist training inside the U.S. that included some what were called lily white. Lily white. You know, those white people, very, very white people, not, you know, Middle Eastern and so on. And it goes on to quote, Bodansky states, the training was ordered by Iran and conducted by Hamas operatives. See the connection there between Iran and Hamas? Iran and Hamas. All right? It's ordered by Iran, and it's conducted by Hamas operatives. And the final part of the quote is, Bodansky sources also report that at least two of the 1993 participants came from Oklahoma City, end quote. See? Two from Oklahoma City participating in this training. Okay, that's the end of that quote. Well, Al-Qaeda, of course, also came from the Muslim Brotherhood. And its leader, Osama bin Laden's father, whose name was Mohammed bin Laden, he founded what was called the Saudi bin Laden Group in 1931. Well, you know, what's the big deal about that? He forms this group. Well, you have to, you know, connect the dots. It's like a puzzle. I've told the listeners before, it's like a puzzle. Well, the group invested, Saudi bin Laden group, invested in the global satellite communication system called Iridium, which began in November of 1998. And that would be used by the Pentagon for its communications. See that? I mean, see this connection, the Pentagon, the Saudi bin Laden group, satellite system, Iridium. Well, 7 months before the 9/11 attacks by Al-Qaeda, now remember, this is 7 months before the 9/11 attacks by Al-Qaeda, National Security Agency chief, who at the time was General Mike Hayden, on CBS's program 60 Minutes, that's the title of the 60 Minutes, CBS's program, this, the date is February 13, 2001, just 7 months before 9/11, he revealed that, quote, Osama bin Laden has at his disposal the wealth of a $3 trillion a year telecommunications industry that he can rely on. He, that's Osama, has better technology available to him than does the NSA, end quote. Now, just think about that. Think of all we've learned about the NSA recently, how they can, you know, tap into your cell phones, everything. And this fellow, General Mike Hayden, head of the NSA at that time, said Osama bin Laden has at his disposal the wealth of the $3 trillion a year telecommunications industry, and he has better technology than the NSA. I mean, just think about that.
Well, of course, if you're going to have an enemy, you want to have a good enemy, and you're not going to be able to get the American people to give up their freedom unless you got an enemy. So you create an enemy, and then you say, oh, we've got to have all this new technology. We've got to spy on every American because we have enemies out there that want to take away our freedom. So we're going to have to restrict the freedom of the American people to protect us from the very enemies that we're financing, the best enemies money could buy. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the reality of what's going on today. When are you going to get involved, or do you really care? Because remember, freedom is not free. Go ahead, Dennis.
Okay, so you know then all of the things the NSA has been doing, what it can do, and here Mike Hayden says Osama bin Laden has more than that. More than that. And so the question then is, well, why would the Pentagon use for its communication something that this Saudi bin Laden group was the part of since 1931. I mean, why would they do that? Why would they hook up with Iridium, given that information? And remember, Osama bin Laden was a known quantity for a long time before 9/11. A long time. Okay, now back to Oklahoma City. The Oklahoma City bomber, Timothy McVeigh's alleged bombing partner, was named Terry Nichols. And Terry Nichols first met Ramzi Youssef. Now, remember, he's the guy with Al-Qaeda in 1993, responsible, supposedly, for the World Trade Center bombing. He was the mastermind. So Terry Nichols met Ramzi Youssef in the Philippines on December 17th of 1991, see, a long time ago, about 4 years before the Oklahoma City bombing. Well, the FBI could have, as we've discussed in the past, prevented the 1993 bombing of the World Trade Center because the bomb designer had asked his FBI contact to give him fake bomb-making materials, but the contact didn't do it. And the FBI also could have prevented the bombing of the Alfred Murrah Federal Building in Oklahoma City, but it prevented the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, BATF, from its planned raid of Elohim City to arrest Andreas Strassmeier, described as the bombing, quote, instigator, end quote. So once again, just like in 1993, where the FBI could have done something to prevent that bombing, the FBI, a couple of years later, could have done the same thing, but it was alcohol, tobacco, and firearms was going to have a raid, but the FBI said, no, no, don't do it. So the FBI blocked another bombing that was about to occur. Now, Ramzi Youssef, remember, who was the mastermind of that, also had planned what was called Project Bojinka. And that project was where airplanes would be taken over, commercial airplanes crashed into the World Trade Center, Pentagon, and so forth, just like what did happen on 9/11. And he was in the Philippines, Ramzi Youssef, with a person named Abdul Hakim Murad, M-U-R-A-D. And Murad, told prison guards after the Oklahoma City bombing that Yusuf's, quote, Liberation Army, that's the branch of Al-Qaeda, was responsible for it. So here he is admitting their hands in the Oklahoma City bombing. And that's according to Paul Williams, who Dr. Stans had as a guest several times in the past. And Paul Williams was a consultant to the FBI. And in his, it was in his book, Al-Qaeda, Brotherhood of Terror, which was published in 2002. And when we get back for the break, I'll tell you what Williams said in there.
All right, fine. Now, ladies and gentlemen, reality is usually scoffed at. Illusion is usually king. But in the battle for the survival of Christian civilization, it's got to be reality, not illusion or delusion, that'll determine what the future will bring. We're being lied to at every turn to justify ever more control over our lives. Dennis, you go right ahead, and we've got about 3 minutes to finish up the program.
Okay, so in Paul Williams' book, he was a consultant to the FBI, and in his book, Al-Qaeda, Brotherhood of Terror, which was published 2002, the year after 9/11, Paul Williams wrote this: while making final preparations for Bojinka, the terrorists met with Terry Nichols several times in Cebu City, the Philippines. Some FBI officials now believe that Nichols obtained contact with Yusuf through Muslim students at Southwest College, that's formerly Southwestern Oklahoma State University, in Weatherford. And that's what it would become known as. And that was in Weatherford, Oklahoma. And the quote continues, the officials further believe that Yusuf and Murad provided Nichols, Terry Nichols, with training in making and handling bombs. Several informants recently gave testimony that they met Nichols with Yusuf in the Philippines and that the American, that's Nichols, was affectionately known there as the farmer, because that's what he was. Terry Nichols was supposedly a farmer. And that's the end of that quote. Well, Al-Qaeda's primary hiding place and training ground is in northwest Pakistan. And it, you know, probably still is. They shifted from Afghanistan to northwest Pakistan, Waziristan, and so forth. And who's Pakistan's head of intelligence services at the time of 9/11, those attacks, was the General Mahmoud Ahmad. And what's interesting about Ahmad is he had $100,000 wired to 9/11 attack leader Mohammed Atta, who was an Egyptian, remember, as one of the few Egyptians, most of them, as Dr. Stan said, 15 to 19 from Saudi Arabia. But Mohammed Atta got the $100,000 from wired at the instructions of General Mahmoud Ahmad. He was an Egyptian and a member of an engineering society associated with the Muslim Brotherhood.
And, of course, this was all having to do with the attack on the World Trade Center on September 11, 2001. So, basically, why were they sending money to them, to Mahmoud Ahmad? Why, certainly, didn't we ever go back after the people who financed it?
Right, and that was just 1 month before the attack.
Right, and so why then did we attack Afghanistan? Because this is not from Afghanistan. Where was Ahmad from?
Mahmoud Ahmad is the intelligence chief, but Mohammed Atta was from Egypt.
Right, okay, go ahead.
He's the ringleader of the whole thing, and where did he attend flight school? Oklahoma. Oklahoma is where Mohammed Atta had visited a flight school in Oklahoma. And there's an article by James Langston called Iraqis Linked to Oklahoma Atrocity. That's in the Evening Standard, London, October 21, 2002.
Well, this is Dr. Stan, and certainly you really need to get Dr. Cuddy's material on this. Nothing or almost nothing we've been told about the bombings and the attack on America has been true. This is all contrived. Why? To take us into a war with the Muslim world. They want to involve us in a war with the Muslim world, like they wanted to involve us in the past in a war with the Nazis. And ladies and gentlemen, most people do not understand. We financed the Nazis, American corporations, American banks financed the Nazis starting in 1933, and so by 1936, while the Nazis were able to invade the Rhineland, and 2 years later, with funding and weapons provided by America, they were able then to invade suddenly the Sudetenland and suddenly Austria. And ladies and gentlemen, nothing is it appears to be. We created the best enemy money could buy. We funded the Nazis before, during, and after the war. We helped them to escape to South America. And now we're funding this whole world Islamic movement. Dennis, do you have a parting thought before we let you go?
Well, I just want the people to look at how they're manipulating the values of the society as a group, be aware of it, and try and warn others.
Amen to that. We carry Dr. Cuddy's books, The Power Elite and the Secret Nazi Plan, The Power Elite, Their History and Their Future. Both of these books, The Power Elite, The Secret Nazi Plan, The Power Elite, Their History and Future, along with others of Dr. Cuddy's books, are available by calling 1-800-544-8927. 1-800-544-8927. Dennis, thanks very much for being with us. Always a pleasure. Look forward to talking to you next weekend.
Thanks for having me.
God bless. Okay, well, this is Dr. Stan, and you need to get Dr. Cuddy's information. We carry a number of his publications. You can get them by calling 1-800-544-8927. 1-800-544-8927. Why would we certainly want to find these radical Islamists? How else could we justify having an intelligence service that can monitor all of our telephone calls and all of our emails and all of our faxes? We're moving towards an authoritarian society in the name of protecting us from these radical Islamic terrorists like the Muslim Brotherhood, who've been funded from the United States since their inception. Fortunately, you can get a lot of this verified up on the internet. If not, you can get books from Radio Liberty, certainly by Paul Williams and others, going into the background of this. But let me suggest those books by Dr. Cuddy, The Power Elite and the Secret Nazi Plan, The Power Elite, Their History and Their Future. And you can get them by calling 1-800-544-8927. 1-800-544-8927. If a lot of this doesn't make sense, you need to get something, my book, Brotherhood of Darkness, to understand the fact that we're involved in a spiritual battle that's being played out on a political and ideological battlefield. But you need to get my book, Brotherhood of Darkness. You need to get our 4-CD set on certainly the supernatural. And of course, that's 2 hours of interviews there with William H. Kennedy, who was related to the Kennedy family. Of course, he died at a very young age, at 59 recently, because he dared to speak out against what's going on today. And it's very, very dangerous to speak out against what's going on today. An awful lot of the people that I've interviewed have died under very mysterious circumstances. And don't ask why I'm still doing what we're doing, but I believe we're doing God's work. We do not get paid for what we do. Barbara and I give our time, full time, to our ministry, RadioLiberty.com. If you're in a position to join the Radio Liberty family of supporters and help us maintain our network of radio stations across America, our telephone number is 1-800-544-8927, and you can join the Radio Liberty family of supporters. Certainly you can subscribe to our newsletter. You can get the health products that we carry. You can get your Berkey water filters to us, your Miracle Tooth soap products, your spices. Certainly we carry all sorts of products. Go to our website, RadioLiberty.com. That's RadioLiberty.com. You can hear our programs there. And then please pray for America. Pray for revival, but pray for Radio Liberty, our provision, protection. And so until Monday at the same time, Dr. Stan, goodbye, and may the Lord be with you.